face out. Y'all been sleeping on me. Better wake up. Put your fly get on. Do your makeup. Drop it real low. And pick it back up. Excellent. Bustin' with the best of them. Super impressive. No worry and stressing them. I'm on my spaceship. Sit back and watch me. Hey, welcome to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by Ogio and FMF Racing. I'm joined today by my good friend Josh Hill. So Josh, thanks for coming on, man.
No problem.
So we rode the other day and I put a picture of you on my Instagram and I wrote, Josh Hill's love for riding motorcycles is infectious. So these days, retired racer, former Monster Energy executive, but dirt bike rider these days.
Yeah, back to just riding. And I mean, I think I love it now more than I think I ever did. I mean, I always loved riding motocross, you know, motorcycles, anything two wheels really, but yeah. I probably loved doing it more than just about anybody I knew.
Yeah.
And now I think it's even more. It's just taking a couple years, you know, away from it, made me realize how much I loved it, how much it, you know, it was a part of my life. And mm-hmm. I mean, I still rode, you know, here and there when I was working at Monster, but now it's like I wake up and just, what do I want to do? Like, you know, what should I do?
So yeah.
It's, I'm really fortunate to be able to still be riding and all that right now.
Yeah. So I have to ask then, you obviously have sponsorship deals, endorsements, but like, do you have a job right now? Just having professional fun haver.
I guess, yeah, it's pretty much how you'd say it. And I mean, I still race. Like, yeah. I'm gonna race the Hawaiian Supercross coming up. Mm-hmm. When I broke my wrist back in October, I was getting ready to race Monster Cup, Bercy, Geneva, and
yeah.
Ozex Open. And you know, I was feeling pretty good. Like feeling, you know, I was actually doing a lot of laps again and trying to get in, you know, decent shape. And mm-hmm. I was excited for it, but yeah. Just got thrown a little curveball and had to take a couple months off, but it's coming
around. Yeah, how did you break your wrist? Because I remember the Instagram photo and you were like, oh, maybe I am not invincible. And it was full curve.
Yeah, it was just a basic rhythm section out at Milestone. And
okay,
it was third lap in the morning and it rained the day before. Mm-hmm. So the track had a couple real slimy spots to it. And yeah, I just kind of spun out, didn't get the pop I was looking for, and skimmed about 3 rhythm section jumps, and I think my wrist actually snapped, and that's what made me crash.
Oh.
And because I hit the ground, like, didn't even hurt when I hit the ground.
Yeah, so his impact broke your wrist.
I didn't have a scratch on the other of my wrist.
So, okay. Yeah. All right, so last year you got called to action to fill in for some supercrosses. I think it was Seattle, right?
Yeah,
and Seattle. Home race for Josh, because he's from the Pacific Northwest. Everyone's really looking forward to him just having this awesome showing up there because he's still super fast. And it's pouring rain, right? As expected.
I mean, you expect it to rain in Seattle. I could not believe it was dry this year. But yeah, that was, you know, I talked about just like going, and I was riding a Kawasaki at the time and just some bikes that Monster had lent me.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like thinking, I'll just go right up there and race. Just go do it for fun and just do it out of the back of the truck. And
yeah.
And then it was the day before the final AMA Snowbike National Championship Series, and I got a call from Keith McCarty, and I got a voicemail. And at first, I was thinking, is somebody like pranking me or something? I thought maybe it was you. And he's like, I heard you were, you know, you've been riding Supercross a bit. He goes, would you want to fill in at Seattle? And I was like, yeah, I'd love to. Uh-huh. And it was a killer experience. And my old mechanic Sean Bell was Justin Barsha's mechanic, who I was filling in for. And got it like a week on the bike or something. Not much time, but then we went and it was just dumping rain. It was probably one of the muddiest races I've ever raced, because normally at Seattle it's like sand base, you know, gravelly.
Mm-hmm.
And this year they brought in complete clay dirt.
Oh.
And they didn't groom it from first practice all the way to the end of the main, because if they took a tractor and they're just going to pull up plywood. So it was nasty, but it was cool. I ran up front. I was running fourth in my heat all the way until like the last corner, and Cooper Webb got me. And then in the main, I was running fourth till about a couple minutes before the halfway point, fell over.
Yeah.
Didn't finish very good, but that was just getting back out there. I missed the, you know, you get burnt out on racing, but I love lining up now. Like, yeah. I love it more than I ever have, because you get that adrenaline rush, and you know, now it's not as serious. Like, if somebody beats me, that, you know, you get these rivalries when you're, yeah, you know, in it every day. But then you take a step back, and it's just good to go out and battle with dudes, even if they are guys you don't want to beat you. But just getting in a good battle is mm-hmm. way better than not doing it.
So you still enjoy the adrenaline of the race, the feelings you get as the 30-second board goes sideways?
All that. I think I get less nervous on that now, because I'm not, like, worried about the end result. It's like I'm just enjoying the race. You know?
Yeah.
Went out and raced Montreal Supercross this last year, and I remember me and Hanson at, like, first moto, we got a bad start, and me and Hanson were just battling, and Hanson was just bashing into everybody. Uh-huh. I think he might have cleaned out Hampshire, ran into me like 3 times, and we just came off the track just laughing.
Yeah.
You know? Like, if we were serious, we'd be like, you know, dropping our bikes. But it was, yeah, it was so fun. And then, yeah, just, it's just a blast getting back out there.
Yeah. Okay, so what was your last full year of competition?
2014.
14?
Yeah.
And what made you make the decision to retire from racing? Was it a lack of a ride, or was it a conscious decision on your part?
Well, the mix of both, because in 2014, I was riding for RCH Suzuki, mm-hmm. and Hart picked me up when I got hurt on the backflip thing. And Hart was just like, you know, gave me kind of a, you know, dangled a carrot in front of me for, hey, when you're back healthy, I got a bike for you. Like, you're mm-hmm. ready to race. Like, just get healthy. Just get back out here. And didn't really set too much of a timeline on it. And then I came back in 2012 and got in the first turn pile up of the first race back, broke my foot. Come back 2013, was riding pretty good. Like, won a heat race or two, and was, you know, got a bunch of top tens and was kind of coming back into my own, which at one point I never really thought I was even going to be there. Mm-hmm. And then 2014, same thing. I almost won X Games, just about won the Australian Supercross Championship, got, you know, won heat races, was jumping all these quads that, like, nobody was, like, they were taking quads out in between practice and the race on me that year, because I was jumping so many of them.
Yeah.
People were complaining. And I was finally, like, back in my element. And then RCH decided they wanted to go a different direction, and mm-hmm. they were, you know, picking up Ken Roczen, and that deal kind of fizzled out. And then, you know, I kind of met my goal for what I was looking for to come back. And, mm-hmm. and then when I went privateer for a couple of races on the Yamaha in 2015, it was just like, I was kind of beating myself up and not doing as good as I wanted to, mm-hmm. kind of thinking like, my best days are might be behind me. Mm-hmm. And then at Daytona, I had a big crash, collapsed both my lungs, broke like 6 ribs, and ripped my collarbone plate off my collarbone that was already Ooh. Broken. And hey, I had to drive myself home from Daytona, and then
all wadded up.
I mean, all wadded up. And it was just like it was not a fun time. And I was sponsored by Monster at the time. And Dave Gallen, like a month later, I kind of told him I wanted to go to school, or, you know, I was kind of looking around at going to school, and he's like, well, you know, do you want to come take a job with us? Mm-hmm. You know, I waited out, and I was so pumped to have that position and transition out of racing, and I needed that break.
Like, yeah.
And I learned so much and was around a lot of awesome people, and it was an awesome thing. But like I said, I kind of was out riding. Every once in a while, I'd be going out and helping out with, you know, film trips and stuff, and mm-hmm. realized that I still, you know, might have had something that others didn't, and wanted us to keep riding.
Yeah.
And they seen that and gave me an opportunity, and, you know, gave me a deal that was good enough for me to get back riding yeah. dirt bikes. And then got Fox Racing on board with me, and I just, every day I wake up and it's like, what do I want to do today?
Yeah.
And it's pretty cool.
Yeah. So when you worked in the Monster Energy offices, I remember when I heard, you know, Josh Hill's working here full time, I was like, what? But you did a great job in your role there. How hard was it to transition from professional athlete to desk guy?
It wasn't hard, really. I mean, I think...
Because probably at that time, you're probably like, dude, I'm tired of being injured.
Yeah. I didn't really have... I had the want to go ride my dirt bike with my friends. Mm-hmm. And go have a good time, and that was it. Like, I always loved riding dirt bikes, never wanted to stop completely. Mm-hmm. So I just loved riding with my friends, and, you know, at that time I was like going and I'd get an excuse to leave the office to go ride because me and Axel would go out riding all the time. And, I was loving it. And I think as you start working at a place, you start taking on more, and then I was riding less and missing it more. And and I didn't even bring it up, but I think Dave Gallen kind of just seen it and was like, hey, what do you think about this? Would you want to do this again? And I was just like, yep. And yeah, I wouldn't take it back because I'm still doing stuff every day that, I guess I'm living out everything that I wanted to do when I was out racing and couldn't. Yeah. If I have an idea of something I want to do, I get to go do it. And I'm 29 years old and I'm still just having fun on my dirt bike and haven't had to fully grow up yet. So yeah. I'm loving it.
For sure. So in your position, did you have to do any gnarly business stuff like budgets and...
I dealt with a lot of stuff. Yeah. I mean, I would have to help put contracts together and work things out and negotiating them and then, making sure branding was right at events. And I had quite a bit. The worst was the ticket requests because we would get for Anaheim or something with all the employees and every sponsored athlete and anybody that's, done a favor along the way to somebody at the company. I mean, I'd have 500 ticket requests some weekends that I would have to fill out. That was probably the
tough part.
One of the hardest parts. Yeah.
Yeah. I know the whole, sometimes the hard business stuff is the worst. Cause in my position right now, relaunching Swapmoto Live away from, the previous platform, the content generation is the easiest part for me. But when it comes down to the nuts and bolts of the business, I sit there in meetings and my eyes glaze over and I can't pay attention. So many, many big props to you for pulling that position off so well when you were there.
It's I don't think my own life is that well organized, but when you go in every day, you wake up, you drink your coffee and you're sitting near your desk. It's if I'm not working on something, I'm getting bored.
Yeah.
So it was good to have to step into an office and do that.
Nice, nice. Okay, so we became friends before your professional debut. We were chatting the other day about going to dinner with your dad and my wife and stuff, but looking back at your career right now, from the time you were with Yamaha to RCH, are you pleased with it? Satisfied with it?
I think that I had... I think at one point I was in my own head and looking back, I think I was on pace to be, one of the best riders in the world.
Yeah.
And I was 18, I was only 18 when I won my first 450 Supercross race.
Yeah.
And I think I got 8 or 9 seconds or something. And, by the time I was 20, I was only 20 years old when I was on San Manuel Yamaha's James Stewart's teammate. Mm-hmm. And, was battling for the championship with Dungey and Villopoto. And that was, I was only 20 years old. I didn't really even care. I mean, I was just, this is cool. I'm working up to where I want to be at this perfect pace. And, it was I was pumped on everything up till that point. And then when I got hurt on the backflip, never wanted to admit that it ruined my career because that's what everybody said on the internet. And I was no, I'm coming back. But that really ruined my career.
Yeah.
And I knew, I never even regained feeling in my foot and barely any, I got one nerve group to start firing again to where I didn't have drop foot. Mm-hmm. And huge thanks to Dr. G because I was going to physical therapy with him for 3 years trying to fix this thing up. But after that, getting on the podium or winning a heat race or qualifying well was just huge attaboys to me just because I knew how withered my body was and how I wasn't the same. But no, it was really hard to be out there working as hard as I was. At one point I was getting off coming back from the test track and I'd get on, as soon as I was done riding, I'd get on crutches because I was getting pressure sores on my feet.
Yeah.
And just things like that. And I was putting in so much work to go get 7th place. It was a struggle because I was watching all the guys that I used to, in my opinion, I thought I was better than.
Mm-hmm.
And had to just kind of be the filler guy, gate filler, unless I was having a really good night. Yeah. So. No, wasn't pleased. I'm not happy with the way my racing career was, but I don't know. I've had so much fun riding motorcycles, and it's taken me so many places and so many amazing memories. But as a whole, I wish I would have done more.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, hey, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. But when we come back, we're going to talk about the worst day of Josh's life and probably the second worst day of my life. See you in a sec.
I'm Brooks Whelan. I'm a stand-up comedian. Unexpected things will happen when you're traveling. And that's why I'm showing you the Ogio Alpha Convoy travel bags. They are ready for everything. Hinamoto wheels, dude. When you're traveling, throw that guy up. Boom, it goes good like this. It goes good like this. Or if you want to be weird, you can even take it like this. Also, what's cool with the Ogio travel bags is they have a single molded back. Super durable. It's got this so it can slide around and you're not gonna break anything. And if someone just hucks it over at an airport, you're gonna be like, that's fine. All I had in there was your laptop, Dad. Come home when I want. Sorry. What I really like about this bag is the fabric. It's called Cordura Eco-Made Fabric. This bag is made out of recycled plastic. Tough, light, resistant to fading, but most importantly, it's sustainable for the earth. Now let's get into some of the features that this thing has. You've got these pouches right here and right here. You've got a space right here for a laptop or a tablet. Also, all of these bags integrate with the Ogio Mod System, which are these cool cases that can be put on or detached in any sort of ways. These are sold separately, and they're super cool and convenient. Say you just want like your phone in there or your keys, or you can put a pack of ramen in here. Looks perfect. What do you got in there? Pack of ramen. All right. People are gonna leave you alone. And you can close that guy up and open up this whole other compartment. That is most of the suitcase. You can fit anything you need in there. And then if you want one mega suitcase, unzip this front pouch and then boom, look at this. One giant suitcase. Look at that. You can fit anything you need in here. All right, let's pack this thing. Let's say I use the front half of this suitcase for what I really need. Dope clothes, I'm very stylish. I don't know if you can tell by my hole in my shirt. That goes in there, easy. But we still have a whole other half of a suitcase. Let's say we're going to Florida, but global warming hits. We're ready for a blizzard. Boom. Global warming hits, and we want to get around because our car is frozen. Bring your 1940s roller skates. There's no way you're going to hurt an ankle on those. What if you're hanging out with a bunch of cool teens and then they invite you to their prom? You want to be ready. It'd be rude not to go with your new friends. It could happen. Let's say you're going to Alaska, but Alaska got hot. You want to be ready to swim. Just put that guy right there. Say you have a family you didn't really know about. You've been absent for their whole lives. Might as well give them some fun stuff. What if you want to look cool at the hotel pool? You can look at butts with these. Underwater, no one knows. Let's say you get stranded at the airport. That's not a problem because this guy doubles as a pull-up. The Ogio Alpha Convoy Travel Bag Series. And it comes in two other sizes. Be ready for anything. Even if that anything is everything.
Hey, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by Ogio and FMF. I'm here with Josh Hill, and so it's 2019, so 9 years ago, you called me up and said, hey, I'm going to do speed and style at the X Games. I go, okay. You're like, I'm going to learn the backflip. Are you serious? Okay. So I joined you out at Nate Adams' place. I want to say you flipped into the foam pit a handful of times and was nailing them.
Yeah.
And then you're like, I'm taking it to dirt. And I'm like, no, you're not ready. Don't. I was scared, you know, because like, I think Patchy's ramp and landing was like bigger than the standard 75 footer, right?
It was the same distance, but he had just like a really, didn't have any deck. Like it was almost like a vert wall. And then it was just like, you know, the landing started.
Yeah.
So, I mean, anybody that rides freestyle didn't have a problem with it because the landing was big.
Yeah.
But, I mean, if I was jumping it straight, I'd have no problem with it. But, maybe that shouldn't have been the first place I tried my first backflip.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I was tired of, I'd flipped in the pit with Robbie Madison. He was helping me out. And and then I went to Nate's that day because Robbie went to X Fighters, I think, in Spain. Mm-hmm. And so I went over to Nate's, and Nate's like, yeah, come over. And flipped a bunch of the pits. I think I was even taking hands off and getting all cocky with
it. Yeah.
And then went for that first flip and OJ'd it a bit, but it was sweet.
And I think you landed flat almost, didn't you? Because
I landed.
Your front wheel is kind of wonky.
Yeah, I landed pretty, I landed deep. Used all my suspension.
Technically was perfect, I thought.
Yeah, it was good. I just went long. Like, I was on my San Manuel race bike, and it seemed like as slow as I would go up to the ramp, as soon as my front wheel hit it and I cracked the gas, I was like overshooting that thing.
Yeah.
And at that point in time, I was like convinced, like, oh, you got to just like pin it and pull back. Like, that's how you flip.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't have it, you know, dialed by any means, but I thought I was gonna, you know, I was tired of flipping into the pit. I'm like, I'll take it to dirt and then I'll smooth it out, you know?
Yeah.
And so I think I just kind of brain faded there on that second one. And
you didn't give it enough, right?
I mean, I think, look, at the time, you know, everyone's, dude, you would have landed if you just would have held on. And I'm like, no, dude, I wasn't gonna make it. I'm like mad, like, you know, just in the situation that I'm hurt. But looking back on it, I think even if I just would have held on to the thing, I probably would have took the bars to the chest on the harsh landing. But I would have been fine.
Yeah.
You know, so just I think I was just been in the foam pit and things aren't going right. All right, ditch the bike. You know, just brain fade, really.
Yeah. God, yeah. I just remember watching it through the camera. And when you jumped off, I was just thinking, holy hell, what am I seeing here? And I mean, it's bad enough because, like, I've shot things before where riders have crashed, and or I've watched Matto do crazy shit that I didn't want to watch. But, like, it was really tough for me because we're buddies, right? And to see you hit and the femur flop, your leg was flop around, you were like laying on it or something, but
yeah. that was just like, I just fell out of the sky on that one. Like, it really couldn't have been much worse. I mean, the way it could have been worse if I was landed on, you know, head first.
Yeah.
But I just fell out of the sky. And I didn't even really catch any landing. Like, I just overshot the 70. So, I mean, it was like just launching off a bike at, you know, jumping 90 feet off a freestyle ramp and then just ditching your bike. So it was rough. But, you know, it's funny, that leg that like snapped. I mean, as you know, that's my good leg. So that, I mean, like the other, I got compartment syndrome in the other leg because I broke my femur, pelvis, arm, and then got compartment syndrome in my left leg. And that was the only thing keeping me from racing for years after that. And I mean, that's the only thing that gives me a hard time to this day. So it was, I mean, when I was getting in the ambulance, like, I didn't think it was going to ruin my career. Even when I went to the hospital, I was kind of like lighthearted about it. Like, this sucks. I'm alive. I did land one. That's sweet. Like, I'm thinking, okay, this is, what was it? June or so, July? I think, it was like a couple days before my 21st birthday.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, oh, I'll be good for Anaheim. You know, like, I've got 6 months. I'm dialed for a femur. And it just wasn't the case because that was the least of my issues. But yeah, that was a rough day. But I mean, you couldn't have told me any otherwise. You know, Larry Brooks was not pumped on me back flipping. You know, I had some pretty good offers coming in for the following year, and things were looking up for me, and that definitely put the brakes on in the career a bit. But you learn a lot and you go through a lot, and I mean, that was I had to overcome a lot on that one, you know. And everything leading up to that point hadn't happened to me in my life, I probably would have been, you know, things might have been different too. Mm-hmm. You know, I had to get through a lot of different hurdles on that one. But huge thanks to Dr. G for that, because more than anything, you know, he gave me a place to go in every day, you know, do my workouts, mm-hmm. do therapy, he'd dig in on it. And he was just the best guy, you know, mentor for me mentally, just to keep going on things and not give up. And he just made it fun. You know, he made one of the roughest times of my life fun for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So after you got hurt, you know, I called to check up on you and stuff. And that was the first time I had heard of compartment syndrome. So, like, when you explained what was going on, I was like, I don't understand what it is. Come to find out, like, your old team manager, Larry Brooks, had it on his arm, and that's why he had that crazy scar. But I'd assume there's still some people out there that don't understand it. So what is compartment syndrome?
I mean, even I don't understand it that well, but the compartments in your muscles just fill up with blood for some reason. It just keeps getting, you know, basically your leg just starts to swell up to the point where it just starts killing the nerves. Mm. And I had been in the couple days before that, probably like 17 hours of surgery.
Yeah.
And then just came out. My other leg was just kind of propped up off to the side. And I was so drugged up from all these surgeries. I wasn't feeling much pain. So I remember telling him, like, hey, my foot's really tingly. And then, you know, probably a day or so of telling him that, they looked down and the thing was like bigger than my thigh. My calf was, it was just massive. So they just had to come in and slice both sides open, just fillet it open.
To let
the swelling go down and let the thing cool off. And then they have to, you know, do a skin graft and, you know, put it all back together. And it was one of the most gruesome looking things. I mean, you can see all the way basically to my bone on both sides of my leg for like months. You know, it was pretty gnarly. And then I never, you know, when that was done, they're kind of like, now they just fixed my, Dr. Alexander had just fixed my femur. And, you know, we're thinking, okay, everything's good. You know, that went well, my arm, you know, because everything was just busted in half.
Yeah.
And then it, you know, everything was going good. And then this happened. Like 3 days into being at the hospital, they just, you know, we figured out I have compartment syndrome.
Yeah.
So it was, it was a trip. And I'd never heard of it before. And I went to so many places, neurologists, trying to figure out if it, and basically you're just getting this grim outlook of, no, you get used to being like this kind of thing. And, you know, there was times of talking about, you know, getting rid of it. And, because it wasn't looking good that I was ever going to get any motion at all in it. And, we just kept going on it. And, you know, I was going and seeing doctors and trying things and then seeing Dr. G a lot. And, you know, he was just kind of like, just, you know, keep just focus on it. Always keep something on it. Keep, you know, keep stimulating the area, and just, you know, stay positive. And I remember one time, I think I'd been going to him for about 6-8 months or something. And it's coming. I think I'm feeling something. Mm-hmm. And, I go home and I used to wear all these like big high top shoes and stuff when I was that age. And I go home and drive all the way back to Murrieta from the beach, about an hour and a half drive. And I get back, walk into the house on crutches and take my shoes off, and couldn't find my sunglasses the whole drive home. And I pull my shoe off and a pair of sunglasses fall out. And I was like heartbroken. I'm like, like, I still couldn't, you know, I just drove home for, you know, in traffic for 2 hours with a pair of sunglasses in my shoe and had no idea.
Yeah.
That was pretty rough, but we did, you know, I just stayed positive, just try to keep focusing on it. And I think riding dirt bikes, it was like, I would just go out and ride with the Hart and Huntington guys, with Kerry Hart and Hansen was and Hansen, Tedesco and Blos were on the team then, and just try to ride and just figure out how to adapt to it. Mm-hmm. And then after a while, I mean, I still shift like a 60 rider that's just learned how to shift like with their, you know, their butt motion. But I mean, shifting is really one of the only things that holds me back now.
Yeah.
So much. And then maybe
did you have to move your lever or anything?
I was for a while. I was messing with a lot of stuff and, you know, just trying to basically figure out what boot wouldn't make me step on my gear shifter and throw me into false neutral.
Yeah.
You know, things like that. And then I'd start to rely on just the vibration of the foot peg and where I could tell where my foot was standing, mm-hmm. you know, just by pressures and vibration. Because, as you know, I have no feeling to the touch, but I can feel, you know, pressure and mm-hmm. vibration, mm-hmm. things like that. So just got used to it and just kept plugging away. And as I was getting good, I mean, it getting, you know, up to, you know, being one of the top guys again. I mean, I wouldn't say, you know, I say top guys in the top 10.
Yeah.
And it was cool. You know, it was just motivating. Like, I just always, you know, wonder if I could ever win again or I could ever podium. Just, you know, at one point I didn't know if I was ever going to be able to walk again or ride again. So it was pretty cool. And I kind of just got caught up. You know, you get given an inch, you want to take a mile.
Yeah,
and,
totally.
Yeah, but I'm really lucky to have that opportunity with RCH to get back out there and kind of, you know, refulfill some of the dreams that I had.
You did come back and win the slam.
I did.
Yeah.
Yeah, I won the slam. That was cool. I had a killer off season that year. Uh-huh. And that was after I got let go from RCH, And Mitch Payton had given me a Kawasaki 450 to ride. Mm-hmm. Or actually, ECC gave me the bike. And Mitch did it all up for me.
Yeah.
And he let me race it at the Slam, Straight Rhythm, and South African Supercross. And I think, Geneva. And I loved it. I was riding so good on that thing, too. I think I was better then than I was the year before.
Yeah.
And but it just didn't, nothing came together with it. And then I ended up doing a privateer Yamaha thing through with Keith McCarty and, mm-hmm. and Mike Garrett at the last, 2 weeks before the season started. And I just didn't have it all together in time.
Yeah.
And just didn't ride that well. But yeah, Slam was cool. Yeah. I still got the belt.
Nice. Well, hey, we're going to take another quick break to hear from our sponsors, but we'll be back real soon.
I've been with FXR for, going on 4 years now. It's a small company starting out. It's growing really quickly, so it's nice to be a part of those guys.
Don't try to be the fastest on the track.
Be the fastest ever. Work harder than everyone else.
Because dedication is everything.
If they say your goals are crazy, be insane.
Be fast.
Be the crazy one. Be unstoppable. One goal, one vision.
This is the new IMIG Pro. It's a V2 lock-on grip, the design and everything by ODI. I wanted to make a grip that was the type of compound and the type of feel of what a pro-level rider would want. We have four colors right now. Retails for $28.95 at odigrips.com and, of course, your favorite retailer.
Welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show, presented by Ogio and FMF Racing. Here with my good friend Josh Hill, who, so after the racing ended, after the monster job ended, just started seeing you all over riding, having a good time. You were actually really instrumental in the development of the Alta Redshift, correct?
Yeah, that was actually while I was still working at Monster. I was living, actually with Dylan Shear, Gage Shear's brother, yeah. out in San Clemente, and there's all these, there's a lot of mountain bike trails, but there's a lot of these little riding areas that you probably weren't allowed to ride at. I mean, yeah. I know you weren't. And I was just thinking, man, how cool would it be if you just had something silent? And then I seen the Alta.
Yeah.
And it was like the first images of it, I don't even know how much they'd been riding it yet.
Yeah.
Reached out to them and, I think I posted something on Instagram or something to get their attention.
Yeah.
And ended up just like, hey, let me ride that thing and let me see if I can help you. Just I'll donate my time to you if I can, just come ride the thing and, mm-hmm. maybe get one of these things in the long run. You're like, yeah, sounds good. So I started working with them and instantly, I think I rode the bike like twice and they're like, hey, you want to race Straight Rhythm? And at that time, a bike wasn't near ready. I mean, yeah. it probably had the power plant for it, mm-hmm. but there was just issues. Like we were throwing chains going, like first time I go to ride some supercross, it throws a chain through the loop section. Oh. And then they were trying to build the suspension in house. And, I remember the first three sets we tried, the forks completely blew out on the first jump, three sets of forks in a row. So that's why I'm like, we got to call Ross. Like,
yeah.
I'm like, let's go down this route. Yeah. We need to, and Ross like instantly like came and built us a set of suspension. It was like night and day.
Yeah.
And then made the bike like extremely fun to ride. Like it was still scary because at one time we were like, I remember I was at Paula and they had a mock straight rhythm track.
Yeah.
And there was a section that you'd triple onto a tabletop and step off. And I did it like one time before, landed it smooth and was all pumped. You know, I start doing tripling through rhythm sections on this thing. It was a trip, you know, no gears and no sound. Like that place was pretty peaked up and pretty serious.
Yeah.
Then I come around and triple onto the tabletop and I'm just like, you know, the bike didn't cut out or nothing.
Uh-huh.
And it was just nothing, just dead. And I was like, just silently, just like I would have been, I was panic revving, but
nothing was going on there.
Guess it shocked
the
something.
The battery died
something rattled and it just shut the thing off. You know, like we had to jump through those types of hoops to get it to where it was.
Yeah.
And this is all while I'm working at Monster and I'm like, okay guys, we have 3 days. Like I've taken 3 days off work so we can do this.
Yeah.
So, we were so unprepared and then to go there and make it, you know, all the way to the, to be battling for a podium position there was insane. You know, that like, I couldn't believe it when it was happening. It was, that was one of the most enjoyable, things I've ever done was that event just because we shouldn't have been there.
Yeah.
And then it just kept getting better and it kept getting better. And at one point they had Dave Arnold from Factory Honda working over there. And
I know
he had all these new ideas for the chassis and we were really going down a good road and that bike was getting good. And then it just kind of seemed like right as it was gaining momentum, things were happening internally in the company and just seemed like that we're making it harder to get stuff done.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then as you know, things didn't go well for
that's
it.
It's a true heartbreak that happened to the Alta guys, but I mean, I'm sure you just saw the photo of the Honda electric bike. I mean, do you think that electric bikes are the future of our sport or an option in our sport?
I think that there is has to be a future for it and there has to be a place for it. As they sit right now, they're not that fun to race. Like, I guess it would be really fun to be on a gate with 20 guys on them.
Yeah.
I think that would be insanely fun because you'd be yelling at your buddy.
Yeah.
You could be talking trash racing.
Yeah.
And hear anything anybody on the sidelines is saying. Like, it would just be a blast. But racing electric bikes against gas-powered bikes is not that cool.
Yeah.
I don't think. Like, I never really enjoyed it that much when I was doing it. But because we were at a disadvantage. I think they only make, you know, they peak at like 40 horsepower. They have a lot of torque, but you got no gears to shift.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was,
you know, there is an advantage to them off the line though. Cause like Mike Antonovich was racing ours and his class was like on the line with mine. And I couldn't believe it. He beat me through the first turn. He hole shot a full line of 450s. On his Alta, because he didn't have to shift. He just right through. But it's funny though, because I guess towards the end of the race, he couldn't do all the jumps because it started to get hot. And you know, when they would get hot, they'd lose a little bit of power.
Yeah, I mean, I have just as much fun, if not more fun, riding my Alta as I do in the other bike. If I'm just out trail riding or free riding, or especially like, you can take them places that
skate parks
you would just get kicked out of in a heartbeat and most likely get a ticket if you were on a gas powered bike.
Yeah.
But those things, like you come in, everybody's like, what is that? They're instantly liking it. Like, cause it's just, it's quiet. It's different. And if I go to a skate park or even if I'm just like finding something to do in the street or a parking lot, like people, you end up getting people watching it, like pumped on it instead of chasing you out, yelling at you.
Yeah.
And there's just something too about just going and riding and it just being peace and quiet. Your bike doesn't vibrate either. Like when you rev a bike up, you don't have that. It's just, everything feels factory, like just tight and good.
Yeah.
It's fun. And I really hope that it becomes an option for people. Cause I mean, even me as a kid, like I lived in just outside of Portland when I was growing up in a little town called Center, Washington. And we had like 5 acres and we had the sickest supercross track.
But neighbors would complain.
Neighbors just complained, and then we ended up moving like 2.5 hours out of town to be be where we can have a dirt bike track. Mm-hmm. I mean, if there was an electric option, you know, you could just practice on your electric bike at your house and then go race your gas bike if you want.
Yeah.
And I just think it'd open up so much more riding and give riding, I guess, less of a, you know, loud, offensive.
Yeah, stigma.
Yeah.
So what's the craziest place you've ridden that Alta? I know you've poached some good places.
I've been to a bunch of places. Craziest, like the one where I think we're the most out of place is we were up in Portland on Mount Tabor, which is just like just outside of, you know, it's right in the middle of town pretty much. And there's all these hiking trails, and you know, people go up there just to hike. And yeah, there's a lot of, you know, hippie style people up there in Oregon. Yeah. And we were riding dirt bikes on it, and I found it was a set of stairs. It was like 24 to a flat with a little turn in it, and like another 18 steps, and we just turned into a step down.
Yeah.
But we had to time it to where there wasn't hikers coming.
Yeah.
And they were like, everybody was pumped on it. I mean, maybe one lady was like, you can't do that here. But
yeah,
it did it, loaded up, got out of there, not one single issue.
I mean, yeah.
We've ridden them in skate parks. I've gotten pulled over by cops on them, and they kind of just like, hey, you get out of here. You know, like every time I've had a run in, it's been pretty good. Or, you know, sometimes they're even like pumped and want to talk to you for 15 minutes about it.
Yeah.
So there's definitely some, I mean, that's the advantage of it. But yeah, I don't want to see gas powered bikes go away, because that's the industry, you know.
Definitely.
And that's what your dad's going to go in the garage and, you know, try to tune your bike and make it faster. And if you got a spec e-bike class, like that's going to be awesome for your, you know, for the price point, mm-hmm. and for the privateers and, you know, maybe another series or something, but it's going to take away from that tinkering and
yeah.
you know, that aftermarket industry.
Yeah. There'd be a bunch of nerds with computers.
Yeah. I don't even
check out this app.
Yeah. Yeah, sure. If there's a bike there, everybody's going to try to find a way to mess with it.
Definitely. Yeah. So, dude, you have like this crazy talent for turning jumps that aren't supposed to be combinations into giant doubles. Like, okay, so we were at, you know, your friend's private track the other day, and you turned a table triple into like one big thing. Like, how do you even like conceive that? And how do you judge where you're going to go and how far? And I mean,
my dad growing up as a kid, like, was just really good at teaching me how to do stuff, like how to jump and how to be, you know, smooth. I mean, he would have me practice casing jumps. I mean, like, really? A casing jump drill. And then like that transitioned on to where like anything I did, I feel like it, you know, I more look at, okay, could I case that? Could I overshoot that? Like, I look at like worst case scenario and think like,
yeah.
Is my body going to be able to take it? Is my bike be able to take it? That's how I like assume the risk, really. I mean, sometimes there's, you know, but you still do it anyways. Cause
yeah.
the reward of making it so sweet.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, for every time I do something cool, there's probably another couple clips of me like slamming pretty hard, like, into the bars or something before that, you know. But then you just get comfortable and you start seeing stuff and you know how far your bike's going to go with you know, this trajectory and this speed, you know, this gear. And mm-hmm. you start looking. I mean, I think as a little kid, I'd go out to Lake Elsinore back when it used to have like 7 tracks mm-hmm. on it. And there'd be like a vet track, and I'd just pull off the side and just be, you know, click my 80 in the fourth or fifth gear and go jump 2 tabletops.
Yeah.
And then once you start doing that, you're just like, you start looking for it everywhere.
Yeah.
And me now, I don't go to the track like trying to break the track record on times. I just go to have fun.
Yeah.
So a lot of times my mind's wandering as soon as I get to the track, like, oh, could I jump there? You know, cross jump transfer.
Yeah, cross jump like, transfers, all that
stuff. I'm always looking for stuff, so yeah. Yeah, trial and error, a lot of cases, a lot of flat spots in my wheels. That's kind of how I figured it out.
Yeah. Wait, last question here before we wrap up the show. Your little brother, Justin, earned a 250 Supercross championship. He's on a factory Suzuki right now. The guy shows so much potential with raw speed, time qualifying and everything. What's it going to take for him to translate that speed into top results?
I don't know what it is. I watched him all off season because I was hurt, and I just went out and spent time with him, and he was so insanely good, mm-hmm. and so dialed. And I mean, I really thought that he was going to be a championship contender. We went to Paris Supercross, and I know, like, you know, Weston ended up getting hurt there. I don't know if that, you know, maybe set him back a little bit, because I know, like, at that point he was so going into that, he was so strong, and I don't know if he's like a little bit worried about injuries. I don't, or if he's just maybe a confidence thing that maybe he doesn't know if he's belongs up. I'm not sure, because he's proven that he's can be faster than anybody in the world at times. I know he's been working his butt off. Like, he's not in shape. Like, there's no reason. Like, it's not that he can't do the 20 minutes. Like, it's not the issue. It's man, I don't know what that. He's just missing one little piece, and I can't figure it out. I think the only person that's gonna be able to figure it out is him. But he's more than good enough to be to be on the podium. I mean, and be winning.
Yeah,
like, I think I watch him and I see him do things on a dirt bike that you see glimpses of some people, and then you don't. It's so much gnarlier than what the average guy at that level is up to. I mean, you see it with you know, like James Stewart would do stuff, and Chad Reed, and I mean, I see it. I see glimpses of that with him. He's just insanely good. And a lot of times he's so smooth when he does it that it doesn't, like, you have to like check the timer. You're like, what? you almost want to make him do it again to prove it. Like, I don't know. I don't know. I'm yelling at the TV.
Yeah.
Like, I get more worked up watching him race than any of my races just because I know how good he is.
Yeah.
And it's, I'm just wanting to win. Because I know he can do it.
For sure. Well, I think it's really cool that two top guys in the sport came out of the same family. I mean, I know brothers are not that uncommon, but it's been exciting for me to watch the rise of the Hill brothers. So hey, man, thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
It's always been fun hanging out. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time.